Hello everyone, I welcome all of you to this lecture. If you see our last lecture, we have completed at this point, that is analysis of a first order system for a step input. So whenever we are going to apply the step input to the first order system, and as we go on increasing this t, we will get a response like this. Okay. And before that, we have seen what do you mean by steady state response, what do you mean by transient response, that we have seen. Okay, so let us move towards the next point, that is analysis of a second order system. Okay, so before that, let us see some basic points related to second order systems. Okay. So we know that there are two types of a response that system is giving, that is a transient response and another is a steady state response. Okay, so we know that the system will be having these two response, and what is the basic difference between this, that you know. And if you see any system, it will take some time to reach the final value. Okay, so before reaching that final value, there is something behavior of the system. So what is that behavior that we have to see now? Okay, a certain time is required for the system to reach its steady state value that we have discussed earlier. Okay, and during this time, system oscillates or response increases exponentially. Now see here, what do you mean by oscillations? That is most important thing. Okay, so oscillations means what? System's output, we can't get system's output directly at the desired value. Okay, it is increasing exponentially sometimes, but sometimes it is oscillating. Oscillating means what? It is increasing the desired value, then coming down to the desired value, again going above the desired value, like a sine wave. We will get the response of the system. Okay, so means what? We are not getting that constant response or steady state response at that time. Before getting a steady state response, the system generally oscillates, and this is called as oscillatory response of the system, and which must be avoided, or we have to do something for that so that it should not oscillate. Okay, so that's why the oscillations at the output of a system, if you take any systems, that may be harmful if you consider any system. Okay, so that's why I think this point is clear to you. Oscillation means what? The system's output is just vibrating above and below of the desired value. Okay, like a sine wave. I think you know the sine wave. So if you see the sine wave with respect to time, that amplitude is, if you start at t is equal to 0, the amplitude will increase, then after some time it will decrease, come down, and after some time again it will decrease to negative maximum negative peak, we can say, and after that it is again increasing and increasing towards the zero, and after zero we'll get the same response, and that is called as a sine wave, we can say. And just like that, system's output will also be there if you apply any input to that, and that is called as oscillatory response of a system. Okay, and keep one important thing is that we have to do something for that so that system's response should not be oscillatory, but we can't remove that oscillatory response 100%. We can remove that to some extent. Okay, so that's why here it is given that a certain time is required for the system to reach its steady state value. During this time, the system oscillates, or it will give the exponential increase. Okay, but if it is giving you oscillations, then it may be harmful for our applications, so we have to reduce that. Okay, so this is called as oscillatory response of a system. Now again, very important term that is related to that, oscillations. If you take any system or every system, it has a tendency to oppose the oscillatory behavior of the system, and which is called as a damping. I think you know the oscillatory behavior of any system. Okay, but if you take every system, it has a tendency to oppose that oscillatory behavior, because that system we have designed for any applications, and it will not oscillate continuously. Okay, so what will be the use of that? If it oscillates continuously, then it will not be having any use, and that such a systems must be discarded. But practically there are some oscillations, and after that oscillations our system tries to get a desired value after some time. But every system has a tendency to oppose that oscillatory behaviors or oscillations of the system, and that is called as a damping. Okay, so as you go on increasing the order of the system, this damping comes into picture, or oscillations comes into picture. If you take a small systems like a first order system, and at that time we had not discussed about that oscillations and all damping, but it comes into picture if you take this second order system. So we have to consider the system's response by considering this damping factor also. Okay, so this is very important. Now let us see next point, that is a damping factor. So we have discussed about the damping, and there is factor related to that in any second order system, and that is called as a damping factor. Okay, so the damping in any system is measured by a factor or a ratio, and that is called as a damping ratio. See, again, the damping in any system is measured by a factor or a ratio, which is known as a damping ratio. So damping is nothing but a tendency to oppose the oscillatory behavior. So we have to count that opposition in terms of value, and that's why the factor, that is the damping factor, is given here, and that is called as a zeta. Okay, so I think in mathematics you may have used this zeta. Okay, I think you are aware about this. Okay, so the damping in any system is measured by the factor or a ratio, which is known as a damping ratio. Okay, and it is generally denoted by zeta. When it is maximum, it produces maximum opposition to the oscillatory behavior of the system. Okay, I think you got the idea about this. We want this zeta as max because it produces maximum opposition to that oscillatory behavior. Okay, but it should not be too high. Okay, so there is some limitations to that system, but if it is maximum, it produces maximum opposition to the oscillatory behavior of the system, so that oscillation should be, we can say, damped. Okay, so let us see the natural frequency of oscillation again. These are terms that we have to handle in upcoming slides. Okay, so you must be aware about this. So that's why we have to see these basics about that. So when zeta is equal to zero, means there is no opposition to the oscillatory behavior of the system. Okay, so whenever if the any system you take, it is not having any opposition to that oscillatory behavior, meaning is that in terms of a factor, if zeta is equal to zero. Okay, another meaning is that another meaning of this is zeta is equal to zero. Okay, so we have seen zeta is nothing but opposition to that oscillation, and if the zeta is zero, means what? There is no opposition to the oscillatory behavior of the system, then the system will continuously oscillate, and it will naturally oscillate. Okay, means what? Suppose if you take any system and it does not having any oppositions to the oscillatory behavior of the system, means what? Zeta is equal to zero, and if you have applied any input to that system, then without getting any desired value or constant value, that system will continuously oscillate. Okay, and that is called as a natural oscillations. So thus, when zeta is equal to zero, system oscillates with natural frequency. Why it is called as natural? Because as per the system's we can say definition, or the components that we are using in that system, it will naturally oscillates. Okay, and it will continuously oscillates due to that internal component. So that's why it is called as a natural frequency, and this is called as a natural frequency of oscillations, and denoted by omega n. Okay, so it is denoted by omega n, n for natural frequency. Okay, so I think it is clear to you. Now see the analysis of a second order systems for step input. Let us see this. Now consider a second order system as shown in figure. Okay, so if you see there is RS, then there is a CS, and if you see the system's function, it is given by omega n square divided by s into bracket s plus 2 zeta into omega n. Okay. Now here again, if you see, there is no any feedback element, but feedback is there, and that feedback is called as unity feedback. So that's why if you see, this is a system which can be called as a second order system having a unity feedback, or unity feedback second order system we can say. Okay. So here again, if you see carefully, negative feedback is given here, that you have to keep in mind. Okay. So therefore, if you see the GS is equal to here, or system function is omega n square divided by s into bracket s plus 2 zeta into omega n bracket complete, and here feedback element is not present, so you can take as a unity feedback, so HS is equal to 1. Okay. Now you know that if it is having unity feedback, then this CS by RS can be given by G divided by 1 plus GH. So here G's value is given here, that is omega n square divided by S into bracket S plus 2 zeta omega n. So that is applied here, and 1 plus H value is 1. So that's why it is not written over here. So multiplication into 1 will be that G value only. So that's why that is omega n square divided by S into bracket S plus 2 zeta omega n. Okay. So finally, you can solve this, and finally after solution, you'll get the second order system's transfer function, or CS by RS, like this. That is omega n square divided by S square plus 2 zeta omega n s plus omega n square. Okay. Now here, please see this carefully. The equation is written as omega n square divided by S square plus 2 zeta omega n s plus omega n square. Please see the coefficients of the characteristics equation carefully, because with the help of this we can easily find out the poles of the systems. Okay. Now if you see the transfer function that we have got here, that is written over here, and this is the standard form of a closed loop transfer function that we have studied earlier. Now we have to find the poles of the transfer function, because the poles are very important, that can decide the stability of if you see the poles and zeros, these are very important, because by considering them we can find out the stability of the system, and that we have to see afterwards when we study the stability. So right now consider here the characteristics equation, that is denominator of this equation, that is written over here, that is S square plus 2 zeta omega ns plus omega n square is equal to 0. Okay. Now if you carefully see this, the poles are given as here, that is minus 2 zeta omega n plus minus under root 2 zeta omega n square minus 4 into omega n square divided by 2. Okay. And if you solve this equation, you will get the equation like this: minus zeta omega n plus minus omega n under root zeta square minus n. Okay. So these poles of transfer function are given over here. Okay. So you can solve this afterwards, no problem. And I think we have seen this formula earlier. Okay. So here, if you see, please recall the previous slides that we have studied earlier. Please see carefully which coefficients values we have put here, and after that you will get the answer of this. Okay. Because in previous lectures only we have seen how to find the roots of this given equations. Okay. See here, I will explain. The coefficient of this S square is A, coefficient of this S is B, and this is your constant. Okay. Now another one important information I want to tell you here is that this omega n square, it is not compulsory that every second order system will have this omega n square value or natural frequency value at the numerator. Okay. So sometimes you will get here as a constant value, but these two terms are compulsorily present over any second order system. Okay. So this is the characteristics of a second order. So that's why it is written over here. Again, I'm repeating, it is not possible that every time in a numerator you will get this value. Here, sometimes you will get as a constant value, but these two terms are compulsorily present in any second order's standard form of a closed loop transfer function. So why we have taken this value? Again, you have to keep in mind that this is a standard form of a closed loop transfer function. This is considered for the second order system, and I think you know very well how to find first order systems and second order systems. Means how to identify first order systems, second order systems that we have seen earlier. You can refer the previous slides. Okay, so let's come to the main point here, that how the roots are find calculated here. That we have to see here, A's value is 1, B's value is 2 zeta omega n here. Okay. Plus constant is C, that is omega n square. So here the formula that we were discussing about, that is a minus b plus minus under root b square minus 4ac divided by 2. This formula is used here, and after doing all this mathematics, so if you see here, this 2 gets cancelled, we can say. So it is only minus zeta omega n, so which is b's value here, but do this 2 and 2 gets cancelled here. And after that, see here, what we have done is that in this equation we have to take a 2 common. Okay, so it is directly written over here that you have to consider. Okay, from this equation 2, it is not cancelled by these 2, but I am talking about the common 2 that you will get after the doing the mathematics. Okay, so you can do this mathematics, and you can please check, cross check, you are getting this value or not. I think you will get this values, but you have to solve this. Okay, I have directly written over here because we don't have much time. Okay, so this is all about the poles of the transfer function. Now why we have calculated the poles of this transfer function? Because these poles are going to decide the system's behavior or its response. So that's why we have calculated here. Okay, so it is calculated based upon the next values that we have to see. Now if you see carefully this poles here, you will get a 2 poles. Okay, how you are getting 2 poles? Because in between this there is a plus and minus sign. So first pole will be like this, minus zeta omega n plus omega n under root zeta square minus 1. That will be your first pole. And your second pole will be what? Minus zeta omega n minus omega n under root zeta square minus 1. So this will be your 2 poles. Okay, so I think it is clear to you. We have seen this, some equations are complex, but please understand this because it is very important as far as the second order system is concerned. Okay, so now if you see these poles, this pole, 2 poles, 2 poles value depends upon mainly upon this under root zeta square minus 1. Okay, because if you see here, we can say that this omega n can be called as a constant here. Okay, so that's why whatever the value that is going to be decided by the poles, the value of this poles, that will be decided by the zeta. Okay, means what? Again I am discussing this, see carefully, this omega n is a constant here because it is natural frequency by which the system is oscillating, and as per this characteristics equation you got this value as a constant. Okay, so that's why I am repeating that the poles value will be decided by zeta only. Okay, but here this is most important parameter that is going to be decide the value of the poles. Okay, because we have to see the value of zeta. Okay, because directly we can put the value of zeta here, but we have to understand this value. So that's why I have taken this under root zeta square minus 1. Okay, now the poles are real and unequal. See carefully, these 3 cases are very important. The poles are real and unequal if under root zeta square minus 1 is greater than 0. Okay, so by this formula, see carefully, do the mathematics in your mind. By this formula I can say that by this formula zeta will be greater than 1. Okay, I think you understood this. See here, if this value or under root zeta square minus 1 is greater than 0, the simple meaning of this is that if you take this 1 to this side, then you will get zeta will be that greater than 1. You can put value and you can check, no problem. Means what? This whole function's value is greater than 0. The meaning is that zeta will be 0, zeta will be greater than 1. Okay, so the poles are real and unequal. See carefully, the poles are not imaginary here now. The poles are real and unequal, and they lie on a real axis and they are distinct. Okay, this is very important conclusion by this equation. Okay, now secondly, I have three options. Okay, you can put the value and you can check that this is very important. You can put here and you can check the value of the two poles, and please see how you can place these poles on that S plane that we have discussed earlier. Okay, now second thing is that if this value is equal to 0, means what, under root zeta square minus 1 is 0, then use mathematics formula, do some mathematics in your mind. The meaning of this will be what? Zeta will be equal to 1 and they are repeated on a real axis. Means what? If the zeta is equal to 1, means what, this value is equal to 0, the poles are, the two poles that we are going to calculate, these two poles are repeated on a real axis. They are real, they are equal, see carefully, they are real, they are equal, and they are repeated on real axis. See, this all the concept that we are studying now, these concepts we are going to study in a future. So please carefully see here, because these are very useful for future systems predictions. Okay, so that's why these are very important. Please see carefully. Okay, and the third one is that I have third option again, that is if under root zeta square minus 1 will be less than 0, or 0 is greater than this, then what will be the meaning of this? Zeta will be less than 1, or 1 will be greater than zeta. Okay, so the poles are in a second and a third quadrant, and the most important thing is that poles are complex. Okay, now please see the definition of a zeta. What do you mean by zeta? Zeta is the damping ratio, or damping factor we can say, and that is opposing the oscillatory behavior of the system. Okay, and at that definition, at that time when we have studied that definition, we have discussed the one important thing is that as we go on increasing the zeta, then the dampings, then that oscillations will be less. Means as we go on increasing the damping ratio or damping factor, the oscillation will be less, and that will be very good for our system. Okay, means what? If zeta is equal to 1 and zeta is greater than 1, then poles are real and unequal. Okay, for example, if you take a zeta is greater than 1, the poles are real and unequal, and if zeta is equal to 1, the poles are real and equal. Okay, and if zeta is less than 1, the poles tries to become a complex. Means what? The poles are in second and third quadrant. Now keep this, all these things in your mind, because this concept we are going to use in the future. Means here we are getting a complex value as long as we keep the value of a zeta less than 1. Okay. But as long as we are increasing, as soon as we increases this zeta from 1 to greater than 1, then we are getting the poles are real and equal as zeta is equal to 1, and zeta is greater than, if the zeta is greater than 1, then the poles are real and unequal. Okay, so this concept that we are these concepts we have to use in future, so you have to keep in mind. Okay, so now the most important thing after this is we have to see the relation between the zeta and poles location. Okay, but before that, let us see the time response of a second order system subjected to unit impulse input. Okay, so for zeta is less than 1 and zeta is greater than 1, where the zeta is damping ratio, so you know all about this. Okay, so now before that, let's see one important parameter here, that is a omega d. Okay, so this is called as damping frequency. So what do you mean by damping frequency? That we will see later, but see the derivation for the same. So the transfer function of a second order system is given by Cs by Rs is equal to omega n divided by s square plus 2 omega, let me repeat this again. The transfer function of a second order system is given by Cs by Rs, which is equal to omega n square divided by s square plus 2 zeta omega n s plus omega n square. Okay, now poles are obtained by equating denominator term to 0 that we have seen, that is s square plus 2 omega n s plus omega n square is equal to 0. Okay, so let us denote the poles by S1, S2, which is combinedly denoted as S1, 2. Okay. Now here we have seen this earlier. Okay. But if you see in terms of this omega d, that is damping natural frequency, then here I think we have solved this. So here it is minus 2 zeta omega n plus minus under root 4 zeta square plus 4 zeta square into omega n square minus 4 omega n square. Okay. Again, if I rearrange this inside, so previously if you see here, we have directly written over here, but this is multiplied inside because we will get here 2 square into zeta square into omega n square. Okay, so please see the difference in between this equation and that equation, because we have to see one important parameter that there, that is a damping frequency. Okay, so that we have to see, because omega n is natural frequency and omega it is damping frequency. Okay, so what is the use of this damping frequency, that we will see afterwards. Just see how it is calculated. Okay, so here this equation I will repeat here again, these are the poles. Okay, S1 will be what? Here the plus value, if you replace this plus minus with plus, then it will be the S1 value, and for S2 value just we have to replace this plus minus by minus. Okay, I think you are aware about this, how I am going to explain this. Okay, so here again I will repeat, this minus 2 zeta omega n plus minus under root 4 zeta square into omega n square minus 4 omega n square. Okay, divided by 2. Now see here how the arrangement is done inside. So inside this, here minus 4 omega n square is taken as a common. See carefully how it is done, and this equation is rearranged to get the inside bracket, that is 1 minus zeta square. Again I am repeating, this term, that is minus 4 omega n square, is taken as a common. This is rearranged, it is taken over here, and this is taken over here. So internally it is adjusted as a minus 4 omega n, minus 4 omega n square plus 4 zeta square omega n square, and from that equation we have taken minus 4 omega n square as a common, and inside this we will get 1 minus zeta square. Okay, so we will get an equation like this divided by 2. Now see carefully what is done over here. If you see, if you do the calculation of this again, you will get the equation like this, minus zeta omega n plus minus, see carefully what is done over here. Now if you see this function, it is denoted as a j omega n over here, and under root we are getting a 1 minus zeta square. Okay, so here if you see this j, you know the value of j. What is a j? The value of j is given as a under root minus 1. Okay, so this is a complex value, so that's why the minus 1 is converted into this. And after that, if you see this WD is called as a omega n under root 1 minus zeta square. Okay, so this WD is not a different value, it is related to omega n, but this parameter is very important as per as as per as the poles conditions are considered, so that we have seen earlier. So that's why assume WD is equal to omega n under root 1 minus zeta square. Okay, and if you replace this whole value, you will get the poles as 1 S1, 2 is equal to minus zeta omega n plus minus j omega d. So one important thing that you have to understand from this slide is that omega d is a damping frequency. So what is the use of this, that we will see afterwards, but consider only the equation for the same, because while doing the mathematics or solving the examples, this may be asked. So damping frequency is given, damping frequency is given by omega d is equal to omega n under root 1 minus zeta square. Okay, so now the poles are given by the S1 will be given by minus zeta omega n plus j omega d. Again I am repeating, j is a root under root minus 1, and S2 will be minus zeta omega n minus j omega d. Okay, so you can solve this equation, and please check that we are getting this value or not. I think you know how to solve this. Again here minus here if you see this equation is written over here. That is not any different equation. Okay, so I think you got the idea behind this. Okay, so we have calculated successfully this WD, and what is the use of this that we will see afterwards. Please go through all these points which are very important: damping factor, zeta, okay, and the analysis of this. Again few points we have to cover that we will see in a next lecture. Just go through all these things, just do the mathematics behind this. Okay, please see the formula that we have used here, this coefficient of this equation. Okay, so I think it is clear to you. Okay, so let us see, let us meet in the next lecture. Just go through the each and every point that we have studied earlier. Thank you.